Dog Works Radio is sponsored by Alaska Dog Works. Check out their website at alaskadogworks.com.
This episode of the podcast is brought to you by First Paw Coffee Company, specializing in private label premium blend coffee. If you're serious about coffee, you should check it out. First Paw Coffee's passion is high-quality, small-batch roasted coffee. They take the extra time to taste and get everything perfect before they release new blends. They aim to bring you a cup of happiness each time you pour yourself some coffee. Find out more at ak.dog/free and enter for a chance to win some First Paw Coffee prizes, a book from our collection, and tote bag. One winner will be selected at random each month. That's ak.dog/free.
Hello and welcome to Dog Works Radio. This is your host, Michele Forto, and I'm the lead trainer for Alaska Dog Works. Today we're going to do something a little bit different, and I'm sure it will be a lot of fun. We are going to get a little bit doggy geeky on you and talk about some words and phrases that are inspired by dogs. I'm sure you have heard of raining cats and dogs, or the term mutt, or even know what a dogwood tree is, but each of these has a very interesting story. So, grab your cup of coffee, sit back, and enjoy the show.
From First Paw Media, sponsored by Alaska Dog Works Professional Canine Training Center in Anchorage, Alaska. This is Dog Works Radio, committed to families and their dogs to build lifelong and fulfilling relationships. Visit our website at dogworksradio.com. Now, here are your hosts, Robert and Michele Forto.
The first word we are going to talk about is canine. The adoption of canine into English is a bit uncanny. The word is a derivative of the Latin adjective caninus, based on cani, meaning dog. However, it was first applied in Middle English circa 1400 as a noun, an adjective in reference to one of the four pointed teeth situated on each jaw in mammals, the canine teeth. The upper canines in the human jaw are called eye teeth. The lower are stomach teeth. The dog's senses are actually recorded centuries later in the early 17th century. The adjective begins to be barked, canine devotion, and then the noun, a well-behaved canine, but not until the mid-19th century. Raining cats and dogs. The expression raining cats and dogs, indicating the occurrence of heavy rain and blowing winds, has been around since at least the 17th century. More than likely, the phrase does no more than implicitly compare the violence of a heavy rainstorm with that of a mighty cat and dog fight. However, no single explanation has been definitively established, and a few others have been advanced. There are those who see significance in the fact that witches in Norse mythology rode upon storms in the shape of cats, while dogs and wolves were the attendants of Odin, father of Thor, the god of thunder, lightning, and storms. Others call upon obsolete catadoop, meaning waterfall, which is derived from the Latin name for the first cataract of the Nile. A more literal and rather unappealing explanation holds that after a cloudburst in days of old, gutters would rage with a filthy torrent that included dead dogs and cats. Maybe this is a mystery best left unsolved. Bulldog edition. The term bulldog edition has been in print since the early 20th century and is used in newspaper editors to denote an early edition of a morning paper printed and even sold the day before its publication date. Bulldog editions, dated as of the next day and put on the street as soon as the afternoon papers, sales slowed down. The American Mercury, October 1926. His assistant already had read the morning papers and the first editions of the afternoon papers, known as the Bulldog Edition, which is really the morning papers rewritten with just a few new angles on the news. In a poker way, the bulldog goes the morning paper one better. No one knows for sure how the term originated. One entertaining theory relates it to the editors of competing New York papers that printed early editions and subsequently fought like bulldogs to outscoop each other. Others have suggested that bulldog refers to the attention-grabbing headlines of newspapers hitting the streets early that figuratively bite the reader like a bulldog. But these theories do not hold when you consider that bulldog also was journalese for filler. Bulldog is filler of current but not immediate news, differing from grapevine in that it still breathes and deferring from news in that it has lost its freshness after the catch. According to the Chicago Sunday Tribune, June 16, 1918. Another theory is that the bold headlines of the editors barked for attention. Regardless of how it originated, the term bulldog edition became an established part of the jargon of journalism. The low-slung canine itself has bowed front legs that are so far apart that the dog looks as if it were eternally looking for a fight. Indeed, its whole body has a sturdy, rock-solid appearance, and there was a time when the bulldog needed all the sturdiness it could muster. It also needed plenty of courage and determination, as well as something the breed is not characterized by today, ferocity. The bulldog gets its name from the fact that it resembles a domestic bull, but from its use in the cruel and savage sport of bull baiting. Dog's breakfast dinner. Since the late 19th century, the expression dog's breakfast has been chiefly used in British slang for a distasteful and edible mess or mixture, literally and figuratively. The bill is a dog's breakfast of errors and technical impossibilities, said Larry Downs in Forbes magazine, May 24, 2018. A couple of etymologies on the expression have been served up. It could be an allusion to a culinary effort that results in something that is only fit for the consumption of one's four-legged companion, or the fact that dogs' meals in the past, before canned and packaged gourmet dog food, were a mess of leftover people food. But honestly, the connection between a dog and breakfast isn't at all clear, nor is dinner, for that matter. Which is the next course we serve, since a dog's breakfast is usually the same as its lunch and dinner. The term dog's dinner fashionably arrives by the beginning of the 20th century. Like dog's breakfast, it refers to a figurative mess, but additionally connotes that someone or something is a mess concerning their dress or appearance. A survey a couple of years ago revealed that Brits love a good project in the home, with 1 in 10 of them actually injuring themselves doing DIY, and there being an average of more than 31 million unfinished jobs in British homes started by amateur improvers but never completed. What's more, they spend on average almost £250 getting an expert in to fix what they've made a dog's dinner of. That's according to David Barnett of The Independent on July 15, 2018. It's unclear how dog's dinner became associated with one's appearance. Another expression linking the two is to put on the dog, meaning to pretend that one is very stylish or rich. But it's American and as such is unlikely to be cut from the same cloth. We always had a Saturday night party when Aunt Lizzie came. That gave her a chance to visit those she had grown up with, and his father said, to show off and put on the dog, and generally to show how well she had done since she left Renfrew County. That's according to Mary Cook with the Smiths Fall Record News on May 18th, 2018. Dog, by itself in reference to affected stylishness, nuzzled its way into American English in the second half of the 19th century. The following excerpt is from the 1871 work, 4 years at Yale, offers confirmation. Dog means style. Splurge. To put on dog is to make a flashy display. to cut a swell. Isn't that interesting, you guys, how we use the words differently over the centuries? Mutt, meathead's heyday was in the 1970s with its somewhat regular appearance in the sitcom All in the Family, in which the character Archie Bunker was known for using it to address his hapless son-in-law. The Archie Bunkers of an earlier time in America expressed a similar sentiment with the word muttonhead, which goes back to the early 1800s and is believed to have influenced the formation of meathead. By the 20th century, muttonhead was clipped to mutt and was used as a generalized term of derision for two-legged as well as four-legged animals, especially a mongrel dog. Mutton itself traces back to mutton, the Anglo-French name for the ram or sheep. The French also applied the word to the animal's flesh used for food. Borrowed into Middle English as mouton, these senses, the word eventually came to be spelled as mutton. Mondo. Those at one with Zen Buddhism will know Mondo as an instructional technique consisting of a rapid questioning between master and pupil, with the intent of pushing the pupil's limitation of the conceptual thought. For example, pupil will say, "How can one become free? Master, who has imprisoned you?" The predecessor of that Mondo is Japanese Mondo. Another context in which you might encounter Mondo is in the title of a franchise of bizarre and gruesome and offensive films. The first Mondo film was the 1962 Italian shocker Mondo Cane, which translates as Dog's World. It features explicit vignettes depicting bizarre human behavior. The bizarreness of the scenes likely inspired the title of the 1966 sequel, Mondo Bizarro. Also, iconic punk band The Ramones used the sequel's name for its 1992 album. But I digress. The conception of the title Mondo Cane is inspired by the film's opening scene, in which a dog is dragged into a kennel against its will as the dogs around it bark ferociously. The Mondo films quickly developed a cult following, and their provocative scenes caused a stir. It didn't take long before Mondo was generalized as a mainstream adjectival and adverbial intensifier for things that were extreme in some way. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle Michelangelo was fond of the word, using it as an adjective in expressions like Mondo Disaster and Mondo Notion, and as an adverb in Mondo Confused. Yellow Blue Dog. In the 19th century, the noun yellow dog developed a derogatory sense, meaning a low, despicable person. This usage probably came about from the traditional association of the color yellow with cowardice. Just before the turn of the century, the adjective yellow dog started to be used by writers who were derogatorily describing organizations that expressed opposition to trade unions. The popularized term yellow dog contract refers to an agreement in which an employee agrees not to join a labor union during the time he or she is employed. You may also encounter a use of yellow dog that is not connected to any of the anti-union sense. A yellow dog Democrat is one who strictly votes the party line. It is said that such a person would rather vote for a yellow dog than a Republican. In the 1990s, another huge Democratic dog was introduced into U.S. politics, the Blue Dog. The Blue Dog is a member of a group of primarily Southern Democrats who identify themselves as more moderate and conservative than mainstream members of the party. Their name may have been inspired by the Blue Dog depicted in paintings by Louisiana artist George Rodrigue, which hung in the offices of Louisiana congressmen who helped form the Blue Dog Coalition. Okay, guys, we're going to take a short break here, and we'll be right back.
So earlier you learned about First Paw Coffee Company, and now I'm going to tell you about its Tail Wagger Blend. First Paw Coffee Company's Tail Wagger Blend is their first offering, and its name and label were crowdsourced from their Facebook fans. How cool is that? The Tail Wagger Blend is a private label premium blend that was developed just for them. It is a medium roast from Colombian beans with tastes of Brazil nuts, grapefruit, and oak. Be sure to go to ak.dog/free and enter to win a bunch of cool prizes. That's ak.dog/free.
All right, we are back. Before the break, we learned about the terms mutt, yellow dog, raining cats and dogs, but we have more. Next, we are going to learn about the term snack. You might hear of a dog snapping or taking a snap or something, meaning it makes a sudden biting motion towards an object. That use of snap goes back to the 1500s. Earlier, about 1400, people would say a dog snaked or took a snake. Those are the Middle English forms of the familiar modern verb and noun snack, which are believed to be derived from the Middle Dutch verb snacken, also meaning to bite. Apparently, when an animal snacked, it sometimes took a portion of something, leading to senses of both the verb and the noun denoting a share portion or part, which were established by English by the early 1700s. At the time, the noun snack was also used for a small drink of liquor. "And take his snack of brandy for digestion," said Charles Kingsley, The Saint's Tragedy, in 1848. The now common food sense of snack, referring to a light meal or food eaten between meals, soon followed, but early use often referred to what is now known today as lunch. "I didn't eat nothing but a bit of snack at noon, and I am hungry," said Amelia Bollock on Ora and Juliet in 1811. The corresponding verb sense referring to the consumption of a small amount of food eaten between meals was served up in the early 1800s, but it wasn't until the mid-20th century that people were snacking on snacks. Dogwood. The dogwood is known to beautify a landscape with its flowers in the spring and berries in the fall. And, for many, its phases signal the arrival of spring and the coming of winter. A popular theory as to the origin of its name is planted in Middle English. Dag, a word that generally refers to a pointed object and that is derived from the French dagger. That etymology is rooted in the tree's characteristic hardwood and strong, slender stems, which through the ages have been used in making strong piercing tools such as skewers, arrows, and spindles. It has been suggested that dog is a corruption of dag, but etymological evidence of that changes soft. On another note, we're confident that dagwood is the name for a many-layered sandwich made popular by the character Dagwood Bumstead in the comic strip Blondie. Considering that the tree had the previous name of dog, tree, dogberry, hound's tree, and houndsberry, it's more than probable that the source of the dogwood is dog. It fits the nomenclature these names have come about from the use of the tree's bark as a wash for a mangy dog, or because the tree's branches bark when rubbed together in the wind. Caterpillar. On looking at a fuzzy caterpillar, you might see a resemblance to another animal. One kind of caterpillar must have reminded some people of a bear and was at one time called a bear worm, later a woolly bear. In France long ago, the fuzzy caterpillars probably made some people think of little dogs. The French word for the caterpillar is chenille, which comes from the Latin word for little dog. Canicula, chenille, also refers to a soft fabric with protruding piles. English caterpillar comes from an early French dialect word, catapulos, which is made up of two words meaning hairy cat. Pelos, meaning hairy, was taken from the Latin pilus, hair. That Latin word is the name, same root as the modern English word pile, meaning a coat or surface of short, furry hairs. Since many caterpillars are covered with such a coat, the name is fitting. Canary. The name Canary Islands comes from a Latin canarae insulae, meaning dog islands. According to what Roman scholar Pliny the Elder found in the writings of Juba II, the king of Numidia and Maurentia, who lived from circa 50 BC to circa AD 24, the group of islands that Juba explored off the northwest coast of Africa were remarkable, especially for the multitude of large dogs that inhabited them. The Latin word for dog being canis, the islands were named Canarae Insulae. Neither Juba nor Pliny probably knew it, but the dogs on the islands were most likely brought by earlier invaders from Africa and were not indigenous. A kind of small greenish-brown bird was, however, native to the islands. Some of these birds were brought to Europe in the 16th century and were called canary birds by the people of England. The name of the birds was shortened to canary over time, as the birds were bred to be the greenish to yellowish birds that we know today. The dogs for which the islands were named have been forgotten, while the birds still remain closely linked to their namesake. Finch. Some might know the relatively new sense of benching as the annoying act of stringing along someone who you are somewhat romantically interested in by occasionally sending them a text, tweet, or snap, but not following up the response. Effectively, the bencher keeps the person as an available option, much like a coach who has the option to play second-string players seated on the bench during a game. In the past, benching referred to seating someone on a bench of justice or honor. In the late 19th century, dogs were also seated in bench shows, that is, shows in which dogs are exhibited on benches. You are to be congratulated for the very fair, impartial, and complete critique of the different breeds of dogs benched at the last New York show. According to known print evidence, this use of the verb seems to precede the verb sports senses, referring to the removal of a player from a game or keeping a player on the bench during one, which are attested more toward the end of the century. It's in the first half of the 20th century that people begin using bench in direct reference to the reserve players on a team seated on the sideline bench, as in the team has a deep bench. The act of leaving the bench to brawl with the other team was given the name bench clearing soon after. Bench warming, the instance of remaining seated on a bench as a substitute for an entire game. On the other hand, has been sitting around since the 1880s, close to the time of benching dogs. Hand dog. First off, this one gets a little dark. In the past, dogs that misbehaved in a violent or condemnable manner, such as biting a human or stealing a person's food, were often terminated by hanging. William Shakespeare brings this unfortunate social practice to light in his comedy, Two Gentlemen of Verona, through Launce, a comical servant and owner of the canine Crab. In the play, Launce explains how when Crab is caught relieving himself under a banquet table, all the chamber smelt him. "Out with the dog," says one. "What cure is that?" says another. "Whip him out," says a third. "Hang him up," says the Duke. Post-Shakespeare, hangdog came to be used as both an adjective describing either the expression of dejection, guilt, or shame that resembled the look on the condemned dog's face or that of the degraded executioner's hangdog is also a noun referring to a person so degraded that he could hang like a dog. Bone to pick. The phrase a bone to pick goes back to at least the 16th century. Originally, to have a bone to pick or to have a bone to gnaw meant to have something to keep one occupied and evolved to mean to have a problem or difficulty to solve. Thus, if someone has a bone to pick, they have something that would occupy their attention in the same way that a dog will stay occupied when it has a bone to pick or gnaw on. It is the sense relating to having a problem or difficulty to solve that the phrase to have a bone to pick with someone employs. If you have a bone to pick with someone, you have a problem, a disagreement, or a complaint that the two of you need to work out, something that, figuratively speaking, you need to pick at as a dog picks at a bone. The phrase, to make no bones about it, meaning to be straightforward, unhesitating, or sure about something, goes back to the Middle Ages and either originated in the kitchen or the gambling house. Thank you for joining us today, and we hope that you liked the show. Please follow us on our social channels by searching for Alaska Dog Works or find us anytime at alaskadogworks.com.
This episode of the podcast is sponsored by First Paw Coffee Company. Learn more at firstpaw.coffee.
From First Paw Media, this is Dog Works Radio. We hope you enjoyed this podcast, and we invite you to subscribe in Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. You'll find a link on the episode notes. You can tap or swipe on the episode cover art, and you'll see some offers from our sponsors. You can support our show by supporting them. If you like what you have heard, we would love it if you could give us a 5-star rating and tell your friends how to subscribe too. Your hosts are Robert and Michele Forto. Our producer is Robert Forto and created for First Paw Media. Did you know that Alaska Dog Works trains service dogs for those in need throughout North America? Each and every service dog that is trained through the Lead Dog Service Dog Program and Michele Forto and her team has an individual training plan. We train for autistic, mobility, psychiatric, and PTSD for our soldiers for service work. If you know of someone that may need a service dog, please take a moment and check out Alaska Dog Works on social media and at alaskadogworks.com.